This is the English Suite Podcast, the voice of Widener University English and Creative Writing.
This is Jim Esch. On today's episode of the English Suite, I talk baseball with Dr. Mark Graybill, a professor in the English department. Mark reads some baseball-themed literature by the poets Lawrence Ferlinghetti and Gary Soto, and a fictional excerpt by Don DeLillo. You'll also hear some predictions for the upcoming Major League Baseball season. So we're here with Dr. Mark Graybill. Mark is a professor of English at Widener University, a specialty in American literature and Southern literature, and our new director of the Honors Program. So I wanted to congratulate you for that, Mark. Mark, welcome to the English Suite.
Thanks. I'm really excited to be here.
So our purpose really for this episode is to talk baseball because the season is just about to start. We're recording this in late March, and you are like our resident baseball expert in the department. We've got many baseball fans, but you're like the number one go-to expert, I think. I wanted to pick your brain about that and just kind of talk about the upcoming season, but also we're going to share some baseball-themed literature, some readings that you've picked out. But I guess I wanted to start by just talking about your own history with baseball. How did you become such a great fan of the sport?
So as a small kid, you know, elementary school, I was a baseball fan. I remember in the third grade, I did a book report on Brooks Robinson of the Baltimore Orioles. It makes sense. I mean, he was a major figure in the 70s when, you know, around the time that I would have been doing that assignment. And I remember also our next door neighbor ran a sporting goods store, and he would bring us stuff, you know, sometimes from the store. And I remember I had a Phillies batting helmet, you know, replica batting helmet that he brought, and a Boston Red Sox replica batting helmet. And I was kind of a Phillies fan, even though I'm from Roanoke, Virginia. I was a kind of a Phillies fan. I guess I was a Phillies and an Orioles fan because I think they were both good at that time. Cause you know, they were matched up in the World Series in 1983. But they had both been good, you know, for years before that as well. But then, you know, once I got into, I would say, high school, I drifted away from baseball and got more interested in soccer, which I played, and tennis. But my dad, you know, was always in the background watching the Atlanta Braves because they were on TBS, you know, the superstation. They were on every day. And it's just, that was like background noise to my high school years because I had other concerns as a high school student, as we always do. And then I stayed in Roanoke for college and again, was not really aware of the Braves or baseball except as background noise. But then I went off to graduate school. I went to the University of Tennessee that was in 1991, and you may remember that in 1991, the Braves suddenly got really good, and they went to the World Series. And I think I was dealing with homesickness, and it was a way for me to stay connected to home, because my, you know, when I would call home, my dad and I didn't have much in common, but we developed this mutual love of the Braves and mutual love of baseball. And so I think it was, you know, it was like a therapeutic thing for me at first. And, you know, I was in the South, I was in Knoxville, Tennessee, and that's Braves country. And it was, you know, a lot of us were, you know, excited about the Braves. And, you know, I stayed in the South until I moved up here in 1999. And so it was a comfortable place to be, you know, a Braves fan. And then, at some point, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, maybe not quite 10 years ago, maybe 7 or 8 years ago, I decided, because the Braves got bad again, I decided that I was going to become like an ecumenical baseball fan. And so I just decided I'm going to just love baseball. And, you know, my motto is going to be that I'd rather watch two teams I hate play than watch no baseball at all. Right. So, and I started collecting baseball caps and really just consuming a lot of baseball information. And here we are. It's also, it was hard being a Braves fan in the Philly area because they're division rivals with the Phillies and the Phillies, that's right around the time that the Phillies got good. Right. And so, but I kind of held on to my, you know, I'm still a Braves fan, you know, don't make no mistake about that. But it just got to a point where I almost felt like, well, if I'm going to kind of live in the belly of the beast, so to speak, then the way to do it is just to celebrate baseball as a game, you know, and, but I think I really probably got serious about it around 2014 or so. I had a conference in Boston and, my wife and I toured Fenway Park and, I bought, you know, I went to the gift shop and the clubhouse store and bought a Boston Red Sox cap, and that kind of sparked something in me, an interest in you know, in baseball caps, and as a way of kind of demonstrating publicly my love of the game. And you know, it, and I started off slow, and then it was like I just, you know, I want at least one hat from every team, and then it was like I want vintage hat. I want at least one vintage hat from every team. And so, you know, in that process, I learned a lot about, you know, teams other than the Braves. And I guess really then, yeah, probably about 5 years ago is when I really kind of opened myself up more to baseball history.
Cool. Did you ever play the sport, like Little League or school?
I did not play in Little League. I did not. Now, my brother was a very good player. And in fact, he was a prospect. He was a pitching prospect in high school, but he tore his rotator cuff and that pretty much ended it. And so, you know, I had proximity to him and his budding career. And so, you know, we played, you know, I practiced with him, and I remember, you know, going out to the field to, you know, shag fly balls with him and my brother-in-law, but I was never very good at it. And I remember one time my brother and I were playing catch, and of course, being a pitcher, he always, you know, wanted to, velocity was really important to him, and he sort of threw one so hard it went through the webbing of my glove and popped me in the mouth. And that kind of put a damper on my enthusiasm for actually playing. It became more of an intellectual pursuit after that. Some of them do.
Now, you teach sports literature,
yeah.
Correct?
Yes, I do.
I'm sure you work in a lot of baseball-themed material to that. So what do you have to share with in terms of that?
Yeah, so I this year I changed it up a little bit. I used to do it by theme, and so there would be a theme on sports and relationships or sports and identity. This time I changed it. I'm just focusing on the big three sports. By the way, I know this is probably heresy to, you know, living in the Philadelphia area to say this, but I'm really not a hockey fan whatsoever.
It's okay. The Flyers suck this year, so.
Well, even before they sucked, even when they were good, I was just not, you know. And it's funny because Roanoke used to have a minor league hockey team, but I don't know. I just never, that sport never resonated with me. So, yeah, the course this time focuses on, we start with football. Then basketball and then baseball. But baseball is the one where I really get excited. And as it turns out, Monday we start our baseball unit. And so it's pretty cool to do it in the spring because it kind of, we were doing football when the Super Bowl went on, and then we're doing basketball when March Madness starts. And now we're going to be doing baseball when the season starts. So yeah, you know, I think this, I'm not saying anything particularly insightful here, but I think baseball is the most literary game. It's the sport that I think is most amenable, hospitable to the literary imagination.
Now, why would that be?
Why would that be? Well, I think history has, you know, it's been around longer than the other games, and it has, you know, it's kind of integral to American history in a way that I don't think any of the other sports are. And you know, Ken Burns did a great documentary about it, which I remember watching, you know, when I around that time, you know, when I was really becoming a big Braves fan in graduate school, that documentary came out and had a huge influence on me, just in terms of my own sense of the literariness of the game. And you've got major authors who, you know, write baseball fiction and write baseball poetry. I mean, Robert Coover, which, you know, Coover's not really popular anymore. Probably, if anybody's listening, that you can go look Coover up. I don't think people really read Coover much anymore. But Donald Hall, the poet, you know, was a big baseball fan. Marianne Moore, Lawrence Ferlinghetti, which I happen to have a poem nearby. If that, and I thought that might be appropriate to read since Ferlinghetti just died about a month ago. But so I think it's for historical reasons, and for the fact that writers, you know, in the 20th century in particular, really gravitated to the game as something to imaginatively explore. I also think that there are some things about the structure of the game itself that lend to literature. I mean, it's a very symmetrical game. With the number, you know, numbers 3 and 9 being so kind of important, but also it's pastoral, you know, and that I think that has always been, you know, kind of a fascination with within American literature, or the anti-pastoral, I think there are some things aesthetically about the game which authors have kind of recognized and have explored.
So. I do think it's probably true that at least in past times, a lot of authors were baseball fans. And one reason for that, I think, is maybe just speculating here, but it's the kind of sport you can have on the television or the radio in the background, but you could still write, because there's a lot of the time, not much is happening with baseball. It's not like watching basketball, let's say, like the ebb and flow of a basketball game or football, like, which sort of demands more of your attention as a spectator. There might be something to that.
No, I think you're totally right. Baseball is the only one of the major sports that's not on a clock.
Although, isn't there talk about
yes,
a pitching clock now?
Yes, there is. They've done that in the minor leagues. And I mean, look, I get it. They're, you know, because it's a business and they need to try to speed the game up. But I guess about some things, I'm not very much of a traditionalist, but I think I'd like to retain the temporal quality. And because baseball has room for reflection, you know, within the game that the other sports don't. And, you know, as you know, writing and writing is a reflective process. And so I think even if you're not literally watching while a game is on, there's something about the way time is handled in the game that makes it easier to, you know, like Wordsworth said, reflect in a state of tranquility. I absolutely think you're right about that.
How about this? I just popped into my head. Like, it's more like you read a baseball game than watch it, or in a sense, like you're sort of interpreting it and you're.
Yeah. No, I think you're right. And you know, I start the sports literature class by asking the students to think about how sports literature is distinguishable from other kinds of writing about sports. And, you know, they kind of go through their process of trying to figure that out. But what it really comes down to is reflection. And really, even more than that, defamiliarization. You know, that sport, great sports literature defamiliarizes sports, because sports is pop culture, right? It's familiar by definition. And so, you know, great writing takes what we think we know and tries to show us something new about it, get us to look at it in a different way. And some students really take to that, by the way, and some really don't, right? They want their, they like their sports familiar. They like, they think formula and tradition are kind of the same thing. And, you know, but if they hold on to that too much, then maybe they don't end up finding my class to be one of their favorites. But although this, it's always well enrolled and we always have a great time in the class. So I think I've been somewhat successful at getting the students to open their eyes up to the whole kind of defamiliarization angle a little bit.
Cool. So you want to share some, what do you have, some poems? And
Yeah. I mentioned Ferlinghetti, a great beat poet who died about a month ago. This is a poem called Baseball Canto. Which, you know, the very word canto evokes Ezra Pound and his cantos. And of course, and Pound actually makes an appearance in this poem. Hmm. Watching baseball, sitting in the sun, eating popcorn, reading Ezra Pound, and wishing Juan Marichal would hit a hole right through the Anglo-Saxon tradition in the first canto and demolish the barbarian invaders. When the San Francisco Giants take the field and everybody stands up to the national anthem with some Irish tenor's voice piped over the loudspeakers, with all the players struck dead in their places and the white umpires like Irish cops in their black suits and little black caps pressed over their hearts, standing straight and still, like at some funeral of a Blarney bartender, and all facing east as if expecting some great white hope or the founding fathers to appear on the horizon like 1066 or 1776 or all that. But Willie Mays appears instead in the bottom of the first, and a roar goes up as he clouts the first one into the sun and takes off like a foot runner from Thebes. The ball is lost in the sun and maidens wail after him, but he keeps running through the Anglo-Saxon epic. And Tito Fuentes comes up looking like a bullfighter in his tight pants and small pointed shoes. And the right field bleachers go mad with Chicanos and blacks and Brooklyn beer drinkers. Sweet Tito, sock it to him, sweet Tito. And sweet Tito puts his foot in the bucket and smacks one that don't come back at all and flees around the bases like he's escaping from the United Fruit Company as the gringo dollar beats out the pound. And sweet Tito beats it out like he's beating out usury, not to mention fascism and anti-Semitism. And Juan Marichal comes up and the Chicano bleachers go loco again as Juan belts the first fastball out of sight and rounds first and keeps going, and rounds second and rounds third and keeps going, and hits pay dirt to the roars of the grungy populace as some nut presses the backstage panic button for the tape-recorded national anthem again to save the situation. But it don't save nobody this time. In their revolution, round the loaded white bases, in this last of the great Anglo-Saxon epics, in the territorio libre of baseball.
I like the Ferlinghetti canto better than the Pound cantos.
Yes, indeed. Agreed.
It sounds like you've taken a run at Pound in that.
Absolutely. I mean, one of the things I really like about that poem, and I like about the best baseball literature, is its deconstructing tradition. And so, here, obviously, he's, you know, critiquing a high modernist, you know, a part of the high modernist tradition, but then sort of translating that into baseball terms. And, you know, Juan Marichal, Schell, and Tito Fuentes, I mean, you know, this is the era when, you know, Hispanic and Latino players are starting to enter the game, you know, be more of a presence in the game, you know, in the few years after African Americans broke the color line. So, you know, there's clearly, you know, it's this taking on the Anglo-Saxon epic tradition, which the Cantos is supposed to be an epic poem, modernist epic. But also taking on the Anglo-Saxon tradition of baseball, and, you know, kind of deconstructing them both in the same breath.
Yeah. It reminds me of how much I like that old, the Giants team too, like that from the 70s. I used to follow those players a lot. I think Willie McCovey, wasn't he on the Giants too? He was a favorite player of mine.
Yeah.
What else you got?
So let's see here. So, you know, while we're talking about Hispanic and Latino players, here's a shorter poem by Gary Soto. Again, Soto is, you know, he's a canonical poet. Ferlinghetti is a canonical poet. Seems to me that baseball gets the attention of the canonical writers in a way that the other sports don't. So going back to your question earlier. So this is a poem called Black Hair. At 8, I was brilliant with my body. In July, that ring of heat we all jumped through, I sat in the bleachers of Romaine Playground in the lengthening shade that rose from our dirty feet. The game before us was more than baseball. It was a figure, Hector Moreno, quick and hard with turned muscles, his crouch the one I assumed before an altar of worn baseball cards in my room. I came here because I was Mexican, a stick of brown light in love with those who could do it, the triple and hard slide, the gloves eating balls into double plays. What could I do with 50 pounds, my shyness, my black torch of hair about to go out? Father was dead, his face no longer hanging over the table or our sleep. And mother was the terror of mouths twisting hurt by butter knives. In the bleachers, I was brilliant with my body, waving players in and stomping my feet, growing sweaty in the presence of white shirts. I chewed sunflower seeds. I drank water and bit my arm through the late innings. When Hector lined balls into deep center, in my mind, I rounded the bases with him. My face flared, my hair lifting beautifully, because we were coming home to the arms of brown people.
Is that one that you teach?
Yeah, I've never taught the Ferlinghetti poem, although I don't know why. But this is a fan favorite, so to speak. And I mean, the students are always like this, and it's a very teachable poem.
Very cool. And other poems, or you can do a prose, or
I'd like to read a section of a story by Don DeLillo called Pafko at the Wall. And this, as we were talking about before you started recording, this story was became the opening section of DeLillo's novel Underworld, which was published in 94. And, you know, this is almost like poetry. I mean, DeLillo almost writes like a poet. I mean, it's so, there's so much imagery. The syntax is so interesting. And again, just the defamiliarization that happens. But this is a story, this is his fictional recreation of the famous playoff game in 1951 between the Giants, who seem to be a recurring theme in this conversation. Of course, at that time, the New York Giants, and the Brooklyn Dodgers. And of course, this was the game where Bobby Thompson hit the home run, you know, in the bottom of the ninth inning, and that became known as the shot heard around the world.
Bobby Thompson up there swinging. He's at two out of three, a single and a double, and Billy Cox is swinging him right on the third base line. One out, last of the ninth, Blacker pitches. Bobby Thompson takes a strike call on the inside corner. Bobby hitting at 292. He's had a single and a double, and he drove in the Giants' first run with a long fly to center. Brooklyn leads it 4-2. Hartung down the line at third, not taking any chances. Lockton without too big of a lead at second, but he'll be running like the wind if Thompson hits one. Bracker throws. There's a long strike! I can't be, I believe! The Giants won the pennant! 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 Bobby Thompson hits into the very back of the left field stand! The Giants won the pennant! And they're going crazy! They're going crazy!
What I really like about this story is the way DeLillo integrates real facts from the game and then fictional things. So this part that I'm going to read needs a little bit of setup. So the part I'm going to read is Thompson actually hitting the home run. But there are other figures, historical figures, who are mentioned. Russ Hodges, who was the announcer that made the famous call of the game. Thompson, of course, is mentioned. And then there's a fictional character named Cotter. He's a young African-American high school kid who has snuck into the game. He's a Giants fan. And he ends up getting the home run ball, which then leads to some tension with a white man that he's been sitting next to the whole time, also a Giants fan, once they leave the park. So, you know, like a lot of great sports literature, this is showing the way that sports and society are always, you know, interlocked, right? I think people often think of sports as an escape from social problems, but, you know, baseball, all sports, but especially baseball, has a way of dramatizing those very problems. But that's later in the story. This section here is just about the ball being hit. But I also should want to point out that J. Edgar Hoover and Jackie Gleason both make appearances in the story and in this section. So Gleason was a Dodgers fan, and he probably was at the game, although I've never been able to confirm that. Hoover, I'm not sure really was at the game, but DeLillo puts Hoover, Jackie Gleason, Frank Sinatra, and Toots Shore all together in the stands as the game is unfolding. So you'll see that Hoover and Gleason both figure into this passage. And the other thing I want to point out here is that there's a reference to a famous painting called The Triumph of Death. It's a medieval painting. Look it up. It's pretty crazy. It's a very apocalyptic scene. And that also makes an appearance in this. So this is what I love about DeLillo, the way he's able to bring all of this different stuff together in a very arresting way. Okay. Russ says, Brooklyn leads it 4-2. He says, runner down the line at third, not taking any chances. Thompson thinking it's all happening too fast. Thinking quick hands, see the ball, give yourself a chance. Bristol in the Appalachian League, Rocky Mount in the Bi-State League, Jersey City in the International League. Russ says, Lockman without too big of a lead at second, but he'll be running like the wind if Thompson hits one. In the box seats, Edgar plucks a magazine page off his shoulder where the thing had lighted and stuck. At first, he's annoyed that the object had come in contact with his body. Then his eyes fall upon the page. It is a color reproduction of a painting crowded with medieval figures who are dying or dead, a landscape of visionary havoc and ruin. Edgar has never seen a painting quite like this. It covers the page completely and must surely dominate the magazine. Across the red-brown earth, skeleton armies on the march, men impaled on lances hung from gibbets, drawn on spoked wheels fixed to the tops of bare trees, bodies open to the crows, legions of the dead forming up behind shields made of coffin lids, death astride a slat-ribbed hack, he it's peaked for blood, his scythe held ready as he presses people in haunted swarms toward the entrance of some hell trap, an oddly modern construction that could be a subway tunnel or office corridor, a background of ash skies and burning ships. It is clear to Edgar that the page is from life, and he tries to work up an anger. He asks himself why a magazine called Life would want to reproduce a painting of such lurid and dreadful dimensions, but he can't take his eyes off the page. Russ Hodges says, Branca throws. Gleason makes a noise that is halfway between a sigh and a moan. It is probably a sow. As of rustling surf in some palmy place. Edgar recalls the earlier blowout, Jackie's minor choking fit. He sees a deeper engagement here. He goes into the aisle and up two steps, separating himself from the imminent discharge of animal, vegetable, and mineral matter. Not a good pitch to hit, up and in, but Thompson swings and tomahawks the ball, and everybody watches, except for Gleason, who is bent over in his seat, hands locked behind his neck, a creamy strand of slime swinging from his lips. Russ says, there's a long drive. His voice has a burst in it, a charge of expectation. He says, it's gonna be. There's a pause all around him. Pafko racing toward the left field corner. He says, I believe. Pafko at the wall. Then he's looking up. People thinking, where's the ball? The scant delay, the stay in time that lasts a hair's breadth. And Cotter standing in section 35, watching the ball come in his direction. He feels his body turn to smoke. He loses sight of the ball when it climbs above the overhang, and he thinks it will land in the upper deck. But before he can smile or shout or bash his neighbor on the arm, before the moment can overwhelm him, the ball appears, stitches visibly spinning. That's how near it hits, banging at an angle off a pillar, hands flashing everywhere. Russ feels the crowd around him, a shudder passing through the stands, and then he is shouting into the mic, and there is a surge of color and motion, a crash that occurs upward, stadium-wide, hands and faces and shirts, bands of rippling men, and he is outright shouting. His voice is a power he'd thought long gone. It may lift the top of his head like a cartoon rocket. He says, the Giants win the pennant.
Great stuff.
Yeah, the thought of, you know, Jackie Gleason missing the home run because he was puking after a day of eating and drinking, which was one of the things that Gleason was known for, his huge appetite, is just, that's DeLillo, right? Just kind of imagining these real historical people in this sort of fictional universe.
That's so cool. I as I recall, Underworld, you know, I read it many years ago, but the baseball that the guy retrieves becomes, he uses that through the rest of the novel.
Yeah, it becomes like, you know, a modern secular version of the Holy Grail in 51.
Well, thanks for sharing all that stuff. That's awesome. I wanted to also pick your brain about the baseball season that's about to happen. And I know nothing about, I'm not an expert in at all, but I thought some of our listeners might want to get your prognostications. Do you want to go through like let's say the American League first and tell me who do you think is going to come out of each division?
Sure. So look, I think in the American League East, you know, the Blue Jays are a very young, exciting team. And, you know, they're going to be good, but I think the Yankees are going to, I think they're going to run away with that division. I don't think it's really going to be close.
The Yankees?
Yeah, I think the Yankees are going to win that division. Boston, obviously, has, you know, they're not what they were even a couple of years ago. The Rays will be good, but I think, you know, they've lost too much from their World Series team last year. I think that division is going to be the Yankees. The Central, that's tougher. Because there's a lot of parity in that division. The White Sox are very good. The Twins are very good. Cleveland, you know, I don't know. They're kind of a wild card for me. So I feel like that this is a coin toss, really. But I will say the White Sox are going to win that division. But it wouldn't surprise me at all if the Twins ended up edging them out, you know. And then the West, the American League West. The A's are a team that every year we're told that this is the year that they're going to be bad, and it never happens. Right? So, the most hapless team in Major League history is in that division, the Seattle Mariners, the only team to never even make a World Series, much less win one. The Rangers, the Angels, you know, these are pretty middling teams. I would say, of course, the Astros are there too. But I think the A's will win that division.
And who's going to win the pennant from the American League?
Well, you know, the playoffs are kind of a crapshoot, right? Because it's as a Braves fan, I can tell you there were many years that I thought the Braves were going to win it. I thought they were the best team, and they didn't win the pennant. But just based on talent, I would say the Yankees.
Okay. And we'll turn to the National League.
Yeah, let's go from west to east. So we'll end okay. with the one that, you know, probably most people care about around here.
Right.
So
National League West.
National League West. So the Padres, you know, are kind of a sexy pick, you know, because they've gotten a lot better. They spent a lot of money. They brought in some really good players. But I just think the Dodgers are, you know, until it's theirs to lose. They're a juggernaut. They're the National League version of the Yankees. So, yeah, I think the Dodgers will win that division. Similar to the American League, the National League Central is a mystery to me. I mean, I can tell you, you know, the Pirates are kind of my next favorite National League team. They will not win that division. they're going to maybe make a run at being historically bad. If I had to, I would say the Cardinals are probably going to win that division. They are always in the mix. They have a great farm system. They make great free agent signings, great trades. So I think they'll win that division. And then the National League East. So on paper, I think the Mets are the best team because of that pitching. But the Mets have a history of not living up to expectations. Somebody gets hurt. There's some kind of, you know, scandal in the clubhouse or in the organization. And plus, I have a hard time uttering the words, the Mets are going to win this division, just because, you know, I'm ecumenical in my fandom, but the Mets are, you know, it's hard for me to muster that good spirit, that goodwill toward the Mets.
Why is that? Because the history with the Braves or something?
Yeah, well, 1969, the amazing Mets, you know, knocked the Braves out of contention. And then they were rivals in the 2000s. And the Braves you know, almost always got the better of them. But there was a lot of, you know, bickering back and forth. And you know, I mean, also I have to say that just the Braves during that time, you know, they had this guy, John Rocker, their closer, who was this sort of Neanderthalic racist guy. And he made all these kind of comments about, you know, New York. And it just, I don't know, that period where they were rivals, just, it's not a period I remember with much fondness. And so maybe that's a little unfair to have the Mets tainted with that, but it's just because they've been the Braves' rival for the longest. You know, the Braves and Phillies are relatively recent rivals. And also, I mean, New York is just, they're the imperialists of baseball. I mean, the Yankees and the Mets, you know, have the most money. You know, they do, the Yankees make a lot of smart personnel decisions, and the Mets do not make a lot of smart personnel decisions. And I think that's been the difference. But in terms of resources, they're always, you know, the rich, and that rankles me, you know, somewhat. So, but I digress. I think it's going to be really close. I think on paper, the Mets are the best team. I think the Phillies are going to be better than they were last year, better than they were the last couple of years. The Braves have some, I have some concerns with them. I have some concerns that last year they took advantage of a short season. But having said all that, I'm still going to say that the Braves will win the division because they, you know, I think they have some really good young pitching. They brought in Charlie Morton, who, you know, if he's anything like he has been the last few years, will be a good addition to that club. But they mash. They've got really good hitters, and they've got a lot of young five-tool type players. You know, Ronald Acuna Jr., Ozzie Albies. These guys can run. They can catch. They're spark plugs. I mean, the Nationals have some guys like that too. But I think the Nationals are starting. I think they're getting a little bit long in the tooth in their pitching staff. So yeah. Obviously, this is the division I have the most interest in because, you know, I'm a Braves fan because I live in a National League city. So I'm probably blaviating a little bit about this. But yeah, gun to my head, I'll say the Braves are going to win the division.
And who wins the National League pennant?
The Dodgers.
Okay, so you have the Dodgers against the Yankees in the World Series. Yeah. Are you going to pick a winner?
Well, that's really hard because that's, again, that's like the two imperialist powers going up against each other. But I'll pick the Yankees because I think, you know, the talent is going to be very, very even. They're both really deep teams. That's what both of those teams have in common. They can lose players over the course of the season and fill in the gaps with players off their bench. Given that it is so close, I'll go with who I want to win. As I said, I'd rather watch two teams that I hate play than not have the option to watch baseball at all. So I'll pick the Yankees because, one, I don't want the Dodgers to repeat. And second of all, a good friend of mine and a colleague of ours, Paul Goldberg, and Ken Pobo. Ken Pobo, our colleague, they're both big Yankees fans. And, you know, if it comes down to the Dodgers and Yankees, I would want the Yankees to win for those two guys.
This is great. We'll have to check back in the fall and see if your predictions panned out.
It's very unlikely that they will because you know, the prognostication in sports is always, you know, a perilous endeavor, but particularly in baseball because, you know, anything can happen in a short series. And so while I think, you know, while I think that the Yankees – are the best team, you know, in a 7-game series against a hot Houston Astros team, you know, for example, they could lose. So it's very unlikely that these predictions are going to pan out. But based on what I see right now, I feel comfortable with those predictions.
That's great. Mark, thanks for joining the English Suite. I would like to take your sports literature class too. I mean, it sounds really fascinating the way you've designed it.
It would be great to have you and anybody else that wants to be in there. I, you know, now that I'm taking over the honors program, it's probably going to reduce my opportunities to teach that course because I'll be on a reduced teaching load. But next time I teach it, I'll let everybody know. It's the more the merrier.
Cool.
Yeah.
Well, thanks again.
Thank you, Jim.
The English Suite is produced by Jim Esch with assistance from Sienna Bowers, Chloe DeFlumery, Christina Giska, Matt Lomas, Gabby Norris, and Shapresa Imarai. If you've enjoyed the podcast, please consider subscribing and sharing with your friends and followers. To send feedback or get more information about Widener English and Creative Writing, email us at widenerenglishsuite@gmail.com. Thanks for listening.